Hey, hello. I'm a Leonardo da Vinci. I didn't always have this big beard, but now how would I describe myself? Painter, thinker, inventor, designer, scientist. Hey, you know what? I did what I liked, and I liked a lot of things. Seriously. Hello there. Hey, hello. This is me when I was a baby in a little basket. No beard. They call me Leonardo da Vinci. Da Vinci means from Vinci, which is our local town here. What's your nearest town? Vinci is in Italy, the country shaped like a boot at the bottom of Europe. Can you see the boot? This is my dad holding some papers and books. He's a lawyer, always reading and writing things. He is a brainy and very hardworking. Oh, and this is my mama, Caterina, who works in the fields and on the farm. She works very hard, too. When I was born, they weren't married, and a while later, my mama married someone else. So, I went to live with my uncle. Oh, look! The teacher won't let me join her class.
Oh, get out of here, Leonardo.
Do you know why? When I was alive, people thought about things differently from the way they do today. For example, if your mama and dad weren't married to each other, you weren't allowed to go to school. Imagine that! Well, I decided to teach myself how to read and write in my own way. And you know, I'm rather glad, because I found that I could learn a lot by myself. As a boy, I spent a lot of time playing outdoors and near my house. I got interested in trees and flowers and insects and animals. Oh, I used to sit looking at them and I wonder, how exactly does a bird fly? Or why exactly does a bee make the honey? Or what exactly is a spider's web made of? Any ideas? I moved back in with my father. And one day, my dad noticed my drawings and took me along to Verrocchio's house. Now, he was the biggest artist in Florence, the city where I lived. He had a great school where he taught people to paint. It wasn't easy to get into his class, so I was very proud when he took one look at my drawings and said that I was in. Now, at this art school, you didn't just learn how to paint. You were taught lots of other things. How to make musical instruments, how to sculpt a man out of stone, we even made church bells out of metal. And then, other things like making fancy costumes for parties. One boy made a telescope to look at the stars. What a place! All the schools should be like that. One day, when I was still a young boy, Master Verrocchio came and asked me to help him paint a big picture of Jesus Christ being baptized. My job was to do the little angel kneeling in the corner. Ah. When Verrocchio saw what I had done, he seemed to get very, very upset, and he started crying. Oh dear, was it that bad? But no, he wasn't crying because he thought it was so good. He thought that I was better than him. And you know, from that day forward, he never paint another picture. One day, I was asked to make a lute, a bit like a guitar, for the powerful ruler of the big city of Milan. It was well known that the Duke liked to buy beautiful things to impress all his friends. He also wanted weapons designed so that he could beat his enemies if his city was attacked. So, when I went to Milan to give the Duke his present, I showed him my designs for some powerful-looking weapons. And a little bit cheekily, I asked him for a job. Well, I got the job! And one of my many tasks was to decorate the huge empty wall of the monk's dining room in the local church. Naturally, I chose to paint a story from the Bible, a story where everyone in the picture is also eating at the table. It shows Jesus having supper with his friends for the last time before he is arrested by Roman soldiers. This is what I painted. It's called The Last Supper. Jesus has just told all his friends that he knows one of them is about to do a terrible thing. One of them will hand him over to the soldiers, who will take him away and nail him to the cross. They all look very shocked and upset, and they're pointing as if to say, "Not me, not me, it's him, it's him." Jesus is the only one who looks calm. Do you know who it is that does betray Jesus? It's Judas here. I needed a face for Judas, the face of a really nasty, mean-looking man. So, where do you think I went looking? I went to the town's prison. I had a good look at all the prisoners in their cells until I find a really mean, horrible-looking chap. Oh, nasty! And I use him as my model for Judas. After drawing the models, I then had to prepare the paint. Back then, painting wasn't as easy as it is now. I bet you just squeeze paint thread from the tube. You do, don't you? First, you have to make the colors. For this, you use colorful rocks and stones. You smash them up into a powder. Then, you mix the powder with something to make it run. Water is no good. You need something thick and sticky. So, we used egg yolk. Then, you add a bit of oil. The sort of oil that you can squeeze out of a plant called linseed. That helps you to make the mixture into a smooth paste. As for the brushes, well, for the big ones, we use pig's bristle. The prickly hairs you find if you stroke a pig. I like to stroke a pig. Perhaps you do too. Different bits of the pig have different softness of hair. For the more fiddly bits, you use a fine brush made out of bits of squirrels' tails. This paint dries quickly, and it cannot be rubbed out, so you have to get right first time. And you can only do one little part at a time. That's why I would often spend the whole day up the ladder painting one tiny bit from early in the morning until late at night. No wonder the Last Supper took 3 years. The bill took another 3 months. I'm joking, of course. Well, the Last Supper was a fantastic success with everyone. But what I didn't realize is that my new way of making paint didn't stick to the wall very good. Soon afterwards, the paint cracked and peeled off, and bits of the painting fell on the floor. What a shame. Ever since I was a boy, one of the things that has always interested me is how things work. In my day, we didn't have the books or the internet. So, how did we find out? We had to cut things up and look inside. I wanted to understand how birds could fly. And so, I looked closely at their wings and their muscles. I thought maybe one day people could fly too. And I thought of a couple of ideas for flying machines. Any good? Well, it was 500 years ago. I also looked inside dead bodies, and I made drawings of the bones and the skeletons. But you find it hard to stick at just one thing. You know, you start painting a picture, and then you think, oh, forget that, I'm gonna do a puzzle. And when you are in the middle of the puzzle, you think, cards! Ah, that's it, I want to play cards! And when you're halfway through that, you think, no, actually, I'm going to have a go at some plasticine. Have you ever felt like that? Me too, all of the time. My mind is running at 1,000,000 miles an hour. I'm thinking about the planets, or studying the birds, or making a sculpture, or doing a picture. And the trouble is, I often don't finish what I've started. And I am a very slow. During my whole life, I only finished about 30 pictures. But I enjoyed it. I wrote everything down that I thought in my little notebooks. Paper was very expensive, so I never wasted a single page. And my notes are rather messy. You can still see my notebooks today. Here's a few of the many things in them. What am I having for supper? Drawings of grapes on the vine. Hey, here's an idea for a parachute. And some people with super ugly faces. Ugh. And because I wanted to keep my ideas a secret, I invented a mirror writing that no one could read except me. This is a famous drawing from my notebook. It's called the Vitruvian Man. It was my way of working out how the body fits together. For example, do you know that if you lie on the floor with your arms stretched as far out to the sides as you can, that is the same length as how tall you are. Try it. Go on. See for yourself. I thought about things in a different way to lots of people back then. I lived differently from the people around me in many ways too. Like food, for instance. Everyone around me, they gobble the huge plates of meat. Whereas I am a vegetarian. Only the vegetables and the fruit for me, please. I love the animals, and I have to cut them up to see how they work, so I don't want to eat them. And then, one day, I meet a lovely lady you might have heard of, the Mona Lisa. I was asked by my friend, Mr. Giacondo, a very rich silk merchant, to paint a picture of his younger wife. She was about to have her first baby, and he had just bought a big and splendid house. She wanted to celebrate. First time I saw her, I thought she was one of the most beautiful women I had ever seen.
Oh, she is gorgeous.
And I could not wait to get a painting. Because she was still a young girl, only 24 years old, and because I am a very slow painter, I organize for musicians and jugglers and jokers to come and keep her entertained. Maybe that is why she is smiling. She was enjoying herself. This is her, my beautiful Mona Lisa. You don't quite know what she's thinking, do you? That's why people call her mysterious. Do you know, I never gave this picture to her husband. I kept the Mona Lisa all for myself and took her wherever I went. So, I, Leonardo da Vinci, die at 67 years old. I was a famous then, I am a famous now, because I invent, I paint, I design, I write, I look, I think, I do everything. And people, they are still interested. Not bad, eh? For little old Leonardo from Vinci.